Let's talk about Pakistan. About 12 kilometers away from Pakistan's capital Islamabad, you will find the Margara Hills. Margara Hills is part of the Himalayan foothills located within the Margara Hills National Park. Within the park, you will come across this structure. This is called an obelisk. An obelisk is a tapering stone pillar, typically having a square or rectangular cross section set up as a monument or landmark. Obelisks are a common instrument used to mark an event, to celebrate them, or even to decry some, like this obelisk in Jallianwala Bagh, Amritsar. The obelisk we will be talking about is named the Nicholson Obelisk, after the Brigadier General of the British East India Company, John Nicholson. The British East India Company had thousands of officers in its service, but among those officers, John Nicholson still holds a unique position. The 19th century Indian subcontinent was anything unlike today, especially in the political context. There was no Bangladesh, no Myanmar, and no Pakistan either. The entire subcontinent was being ruled by a single power, the East India Company. The company was ruling with its iron hand, and it had only one intention in its mind: acquire more profit. What started as a mediocre trading establishment soon grew into a giant with its grip over the entire subcontinent. The company had its own army, its own postal service, and even started its own train service. But all this came at the cost of the native Indians. The local handicraft industry was destroyed, the peasants were charged with heavy taxes, and the punishment for not paying them was severe. The majority of the Indian populace hated the Company Raj. It was during the height of the Company Raj that the revolt of 1857 took place. The reasons behind this revolt, also called the First War of Indian Independence, are numerous and they deserve an entire video of their own. The revolt quickly spread to many parts and the company had to quickly bring in many officers to quell the revolt before it engulfed the entire subcontinent. Like the company, John Nicholson was also cruel, and not just cruel and inhumane, he was cruel to his bare bone. Detailed instances of his cruelty have been given in British author William Dalrymple's book, The Last Mughal. Like for instance, he thrashed a boy to death simply because he had accidentally come in the way of his march. In another incident described in the book, he hung all the regimental cooks when he got to know that the food was laced with poison. When he asked the cooks to eat the food they had prepared, the cooks refused. And immediately he ordered them to be hanged. And as per a witness, the regimental cooks were seen ornamenting a neighboring tree. It isn't surprising to see as to why the British built a memorial in his name. He fought and died for the company. But would it be possible for the native Indians to admire and revere the very man who had oppressed and tortured them? Yes, they did. So much that they even formed a cult in his name, the Nickel Sign. To understand why John Nicholson developed a cult around him, we need to look at his origins. Nicholson's father died when he was 9 years old. He was the eldest male in his family, and his uncle raised him through hard times, eventually helping him grab a cadetship in the Bengal Infantry of the East India Company. He left for India at a very young age of 17, never to return to his homeland. The loss of a parent at a very young age, the separation from his immediate family, all this might have affected his resolve and might have made him rough and crude. Nicholson's character was further molded by his involvement in the First Anglo-Afghan War of 1840. In a battle which was part of the war, Nicholson's party had to surrender to the Afghans, and he was forced to watch in tears as his sepoys were slaughtered after refusing to convert to Islam. He remained in the captivity of the Afghans for 6 long months, during which his hatred for the Afghans started growing. This hatred reached its peak when he found the mutilated body of his younger brother Alexander, who was killed in an Afghan ambush. Nicholson's first experience of war, along with his hatred towards the Afghans and the entirety of India, instilled in him a feeling of near messianic sense of destiny. It must be noted that Nicholson was a stern Victorian Christian who read a chapter of the Bible every day. A few years later, in 1848, things were really heating up between the Sikhs and the British in the Punjab region of the Northwest Province. The East India Company kept its army away from the region. Nicholson then decided to take matters into his own hand. He and a few horsemen rode straight to a fort in Attock, which was crucial for the British line of communication. Upon arrival to the fort, Nicholson rode straight past the stunned Sikh sentries guarding the main gate. When the Sikh sepoys further inside the fort raised their weapons against him, Nicholson leaped from his horse and wrestled the musket away from the nearest sepoy before shouting at them to lay down their arms and leave the fort, which the stunned Sikh garrison promptly did. This action, which was to become the first of Nicholson's famed exploits among the Sikhs, had enabled him to secure the vital fort without firing a single shot. Nicholson followed up this action just days later when he heard a Sikh infantry regiment were moving through the Margalla Hills in order to join the rebellion. Nicholson left Attock with his trusted irregulars and met the Sikh force camped at a Muslim cemetery. Nicholson rode up to the enemy camp and demanded to speak with their colonel, whom he gave 1 hour to submit their loyalty to him and be spared or else be destroyed. The Sikhs argued for an hour in front of the imposing figure of Nicholson, who sat motionless on his horse for the entire duration. It must be noted that he was at least 6 feet 2 inches tall, with broad shoulders, a great beard, and a deep Anglo-Irish accent. Upon the hour mark, the Sikhs returned to Nicholson and declared their willingness to submit to his authority, thus cementing the growing legend of Nicholson among the Sikh people. Tales of his heroics did not stop there. Following the complete annexation of Punjab into the British Raj, Nicholson was appointed the new deputy commissioner at Rawalpindi. He soon set about imposing his unique brutality on law and order in the region. In one incident, after placing a bounty on a particularly troublesome local robber failed to result in his arrest, Nicholson rode out alone to the man's village and demanded him to surrender. When the robber refused this offer, Nicholson fought and killed him before decapitating his body. He then placed the man's head on his desk as a warning to all other criminals who may be tempted to defy him. In yet another instance, Nicholson noticed an imam who, engrossed with other things, had not greeted him with the customary salam. He had the unfortunate man brought before him and with his own hands shaved his beard off, a deep humiliation for a Muslim, as Nicholson well knew. A few years later, in January 1852, Nicholson was appointed as the new deputy commissioner of the largely lawless Bannu area, which is today in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. In this role, Nicholson was ruthless in bringing peace and order to the region with a zero-tolerance attitude on crime or any perceived disrespect of British rule, often using flogging or other similar methods to both punish and humiliate anyone who dared infringe the law. At first, he was feared for his foul temper and authoritarian manner, which underpinned his tyrant-style rule. But Nicholson soon gained the respect of the Afghan and North Punjabi tribes in the area for his fair-handedness and sense of honor, as well as his complete elimination of crime. The respect that Nicholson had first gained from the Sikh people and then the Punjabi tribes became religious worship as the Nicholsine cult developed, which worshipped Nicholson as a saint-like figure who brought justice to the oppressed by punishing the strong. The Nicholsinese, as they were called, wore garments the color of faded leaves and followed Nicholson wherever he traveled. Somewhere down the line, Nicholsine assumed the status of a Muslim saint. Stories were told of him dispensing rough justice on those who terrorized the poor. According to legend, he once mistakenly chopped off a man's head, but realizing his mistake, stuck it back on again. So what was Nicholson's response to his fan following? Rather than be flattered by this religious devotion, Nicholson found his Christian beliefs offended by the worship and would promptly whip any of the devotees who publicly practiced this cult in his presence. This, however, merely strengthened their conviction that he was a god, and the cult lingered on long after his death in surprising forms and ways in some remoter parts of northwest Pakistan, even into the 21st century. The last of the Nikal Sainis died only in 2004 in the Pakistani town of Abbottabad. Nicholson himself was, however, wounded during the Battle of Najafgarh and died at the age of 34 years. He was buried under a slab of plain granite in a cemetery that is now called the Nicholson Cemetery in Delhi. Nicholson's memory is represented through numerous monuments and statues which stand in his honor. A couple of them exist in Northern Ireland. The obelisk which we saw in the beginning in Margalla Hills, Pakistan, was erected in 1868 and still stands to this date, surprisingly. The one monument in Delhi was, however, removed following Indian independence and moved to his former school in County Tyrone in Ireland. Nicholson's life is an interesting tale of the oppressed worshipping the oppressor. The cult stood as a reminder of the soldier's bravery coupled with tyranny and legends, some of which were certainly apocryphal.